Princess Bride by S. Morgenstern. The Good Parts Abridgment by William Goldman, my son. Adapted by Stephen Keyworth? Keyworth? The more I say it, the more it sounds wrong. Previously, boy meets girl. Boy goes to make his fortune and gets killed by pirates. Shame. Girl agrees to marry prince. Prince arranges kidnap because rich people. Boy comes back from dead to rescue princess. Princess agrees to marry royal schmuck to save boy's life. What? Details? You should have been paying attention. Chapter 6. The festivities.
So, by the power invested in me, I now pronounce you man and wife.
All hail for the royal couple, King Humperdinck and Queen Buttercup.
Are you happy, my sweetness?
Yes, I hope so.
Is
she paying me?
Guards, remove that old crone.
Wait, bring her here. Have we met?
Never.
Then why do you insult the queen?
Because you had love in your hands and you dropped it like garbage. That's what you are, the queen of garbage.
I gave my word to the prince.
Who saved your life in the fire swamp? Who came back from the dead for you? She threw love away to be the queen of muck.
Buttercup was in her bed, alone. The wedding was still 60 days away.
Hey, not fair.
Well, how about giving old Morgenstern credit for a major league fake out there? I mean, didn't you think for a moment that they really were married?
Yes, I didn't like it.
I'm sorry. Go back to sleep. It's one of my biggest memories of my father reading. And the next night, when I found out it was only a dream, I screamed, I knew it! I knew
it! Shush!
But that's what this book is about. Sometimes the wrong people get married. Sometimes the wrong people die. You want to know why? Because life isn't fair.
Hey, you want to give him nightmares?
I turned out okay.
Yeah.
What else happened? Wesley beat the princess's kidnappers fair and square. Although, it turned out they weren't such bad people.
Vizzini! Vizzini, where are you? Oh, you're dead.
It's okay. We didn't like that one.
Inigo! Inigo, where are you?
Where, indeed?
Where are you, Fezzik? Why do you never remember the meeting places, huh? I am Inigo Montoya, and I demand more brandy!
Also, Prince Humperdinck became popular, something which never happened because his all-time top three was hunting, war, and hunting with a war side salad. The prince made it known that the neighboring country of Gilder were responsible for his fiancée's kidnapping. Fearlessly, he had tracked her kidnappers and rescued the beloved princess, finding time to pardon a young pirate called Wesley.
Fake news! I love it.
Meanwhile, Wesley woke up in the lowest levels of the prince's secret zoo of death. You see why he's not always popular.
Who are you? Where are we? Say something, even if it's a lie. Who knows I'm here?
I know. They.
They?
No.
The prince and the count, you mean? When I was brought in, three soldiers carried me. They know too.
New.
They're dead? Am I to die then?
The machine is almost ready.
Wow, that was chilling. Did you know that was going to happen? Can you do it again?
Let me kill you.
What? No!
You'll thank me.
No, I'm going to survive this. They won't break me, because I am in actual fact none other than the Dread Pirate Roberts. I thought you'd be more impressed.
I meet a lot of people here.
Well, you'll see.
Dead Pirate Roberts, more like.
My prince, I must speak to you at once.
Of course, my cherry pie. Sit.
I don't know how to say this. I love Wesley. I didn't know he was alive when you came to me. When you said I must marry you or face death, I answered, kill me. I meant that. I mean this now too. If you say I must marry you in 50 days, I will be dead by morning.
Princess.
I'm sorry.
I admit, when we first became engaged, there was to be no love involved, but you must have noticed in these last weeks a certain warming of my attitude.
I have. You have been both sweet and noble.
Yes. Having said that, I would die myself rather than cause you unhappiness by standing in the way of you marrying the man you love.
So it's settled then? Our wedding is off?
Yes. Except...
Except?
My little sugar cookie. Have you considered the possibility that he might not want to marry you any longer? Consider. He has had time to survive the emotional scars you dealt him. What if he wants now to remain single? Or worse, what if he has found another? Here's what I suggest. If Wesley wants to marry you still, bless you both. If, for reasons unpleasant, his pride will not let him, then you will marry me, as planned, and be the Queen of Florin.
But how can I find out?
Write a letter. I will make 4 copies and send my 4 fastest ships, and whichever ship finds him will deliver your letter. If no, Wesley can speak that message to my captain. If yes, my captain will sail him here, and I will have to content myself somehow with a lesser bride.
I think that this is the most generous decision I have yet heard.
Do me this favor, then. Until we know Wesley's intentions, let us continue as we have, so the festivities will not be halted, and if I seem too fond of you, remember that I cannot help myself.
Agreed.
Off now, blueberry muffin, and write your letter.
There was no doubt in his mind that he was going to seem too fond of her in the days ahead, because when she died of murder on their wedding night, it was crucial that all Florin realized the depth of his love, so then no one would dare hesitate to follow him in the revenge war he was to launch against Gilder.
Sneaky, aren't I? Wesley, please don't get up. You remember Count Rugen?
Yes.
Hello.
Good morning, gentlemen. Or evening, it's hard to tell.
Before we begin, have you any complaints about your treatment thus far?
None.
Good. Then I promise you this. Answer the next question, and I will set you free this night. Who hired you to kidnap the princess?
No one hired me, and I didn't kidnap her. I saved her from others who were doing that very thing.
Now, you seem a reasonable fellow, so I will give you one final chance. The name of the man in Gilder who hired you. Tell me or face torture.
No one hired me, I swear.
In which case, it is out of my hands.
Speaking of hands...
Thanks. My hands were feeling a little chapped. What kind of oil is that? Sandalwood?
It's flammable.
No.
Pass me the candle. Who hired you, Wesley?
No one.
Who hired you?
No one. No one! No one hired me! On my life!
Who hired you?
Meanwhile... Sorry, I'll wait. Meanwhile, upstairs, Buttercup was also in agony.
Is something the matter, sweet potato?
My letter. I cannot get it right.
Please. Read to me.
Wesley, my passion, my sweets, my only. Come back, come back. I shall kill myself otherwise. Yours in torment, Buttercup. Well, too forward?
It doesn't leave a great deal of room to maneuver.
Will you help me?
Of course. Perhaps if I knew more about him. Is he really so wonderful, this Wesley?
Not so much wonderful as flawless. Also magnificent. Mm. Rather on the ideal side. Huh. Am I being helpful?
I think emotions are clouding your objectivity just a touch. Do you really think that there is nothing the fellow can't do?
It's not so much that there is nothing he can't do. It's more that he can do it better than anyone else.
Well, in other words, for example, you mean if he wanted to hunt, he could out-hunt again, for example, someone such as myself?
Oh, yes.
Well, why don't we just begin our letter with Divine Wesley and appeal to his sense of modesty?
All of this was irritating to Humperdinck. If only Buttercup would admit that he, Humperdinck, was the better man. But she would not. All she ever talked about was Wesley. All she ever asked about was news of Wesley. Days went by, weeks, and all Florin was moved by the spectacle of their prince at last so clearly and wonderfully in love. But when they were alone...
I wonder where could Wesley be? What could be taking him so long?
Maddening.
Plus, the prince had no time.
Look, Rugi, I'm really anxious to see this machine of yours working, but honestly, I'm swamped. I've got a 500th anniversary to plan, a wife to murder, and wars don't wage themselves. So how about you go to work on Wesley, and I'll pop along when I can. But for now, a little breathing room, no hard feelings, yeah?
None.
Finally, no rest for the... Well, you know.
Good morning, Wesley. Hope we didn't wake you setting up my machine. It took 11 years to get right. You've been hearing the screams. Wild dogs. I'm very interested in pain, as I'm sure you've gathered. I'm writing a book. One of my theories is that pain involves anticipation. I'll be taking notes. I hope you don't mind. But I want you to know, before I start, you are the strongest, the most brilliant and worthy creature it has ever been my privilege to meet. I feel almost sad that, for the purposes of my book and future pain scholars, I must destroy you. And you can stop all your performing about how weak and beaten you are. You haven't fooled me for a month. I know your secret.
Secret?
You've been taking your brain away. You haven't felt the least discomfort. You raise your eyes and drop your eyelids and you're away. With her, most likely. Am I right?
Or gave me away.
Good. No more charades. I suppose you're curious as to how this works.
It appears to be a great conglomeration of soft-rimmed cups of infinitely varied sizes, together with a wheel and a dial and a lever. But what it does is beyond me.
Also, glue to keep the cups attached like so. There will be a little more anticipation now while we attach them to all of your exposed skin.
This certainly isn't the easiest thing to set up, is it?
Are you really as brave as you sound? Or are you a little frightened? The truth, please, for posterity.
I'm a little frightened.
Good. So much for the outside. The next part is a bit more delicate. Try not to move.
Soon, there were tiny soft-rimmed cups on the insides of Wesley's nostrils, against his eardrums, under his eyelids, and other places. Before the count arose, Wesley was covered inside and out.
Now, the dial can be set from 1 to 20. This being the first time, I will set it at the lowest setting, which is 1. Then, all I need to do is gently push this lever.
But Wesley, as the lever moved, took his brain away to Buttercup, and when the machine began to work, Wesley was stroking her autumn-colored hair, and then his world exploded because the cups... And before, Rugen had punished his body but left his brain, not the machine. The machine reached everywhere. His eyes were not his. His ears could not hear, and his brain slid far, far from love into the deep vault of despair and down through the house of agony into the county of pain. Wesley's world was ripping apart, and he could do nothing but crack along with it.
The concept of the suction pump is centuries old. Basically, that's all this is, except instead of water, I've just sucked away 1 year of your life. Later, I'll set the dial to 2, 3, perhaps even 5. Theoretically, 5 should be 5 times more severe. So, please, be specific in your answers. Tell me, honestly, how do you feel? Interesting.
While the Count worked quietly on his book, Prince Humperdinck put into place the next stage of his plan to start a war with Gilder.
My most excellent castle guards and the other ones we hired quickly to bulk up the numbers, I have heard from unimpeachable sources that Gilder's spies have infiltrated our usually respectable thieves' quarter.
Quarter?
The big one is thirsty. Get him a drink. He's right. Bring jugs. Drinks for everyone. Our spies are planning another attempt on the life of my beloved, so I want the whole area cleared immediately of anyone who looks suspicious or a bit foreign. Any questions? No, of course not.
I'm bored, Vizzini. 2 months is too long, and you are a tardy Sicilian.
Castle guard, open up.
Go away. I'm busy.
Get the giant. Open this door.
I like that door.
Get him out.
I'm waiting for the Zini.
Meanie?
I'm not mean. I'm just following the rule.
Cruel?
Not cruel, not mean. Can't you understand? I'm... Fezzik?
Who says ick?
Fezzik? Is that a joke you made? Fezzik! It's you!
True!
That's right. Hold him there, and we'll...
It's so good to see you, Fezzik. But, so much brandy. What happened?
I made soup.
Oh, you make soup now?
I boiled some things. Huh. You're a bit yellow, fellow.
I've done nothing for weeks but wait for Vizzini and drink brandy, and the shock of seeing you, it was too much. But I'm fine now.
Good. Vizzini is dead.
She is? Oh, that's just...
Stupid Fezzik. No more shocks.
Fezzik. Oh. First the shock of seeing you, and then the news of Vizzini.
Just rest. You'll be as strong as ever by sundown.
Oh, I feel such a baby. So helpless. Could you cut up my soup for me?
Of course. And no more surprises. Oh, by the way, the six-fingered man who killed your father? His name is Count Rugen, and he lives right here in Florence City.
Well, isn't that just...
I need to stop blurting things out.
Inigo slept. He dreamt of his dead father and his long quest to find his killer. He dreamt of all the fascinating things that happened, which you can hear in his bite-sized backstory that's available now. When he woke up, there was still soup.
Acceptable. Tell me where the six-fingered man is, so I may go and kill him.
That won't be easy. He's in the castle with the prince, and the gate is guarded by 20 men.
If you fought five, and I fenced five, that would mean 10 gone, which would still mean 10 left, and they would kill us. But if you could take six, and I took eight, how many could you handle at most?
Probably eight.
Leaving me 12, which is not impossible, but not the best way to spend your first evening after weeks on brandy. I need Vizzini. I'm not a planner. Fezzik, help me.
Well, I'm the stupidest fellow that was ever born. You know that.
I don't need Vizzini. I need the man in black. He bested all of us, and he will tell me how to break into the castle. Where is he?
He sails the seven seas with the dread pirate Robert. Count Rugen said so. And the prince wants no pirates around. Well, with all the trouble he's having with Gilder. Remember, they kidnapped the princess once.
Fezzik, we kidnapped the princess once. Never were strong on memory. Somebody wanted Gilder to look guilty, and I guess it was the war-loving prince himself. As for the man in black's whereabouts, since Count Rugen is the same man who slaughtered my father, we can rest assured he is certainly a trustworthy fellow. Come! We must hurry.
Where are we going?
No idea. But when we find the man in black, we'll ask him.
So, for this next scene, we had a big Hollywood actor wanting to do a cameo as the chief palace guard. The biggest. That person you're thinking of? Him.
My prince, I'm sorry to interrupt.
Sweetness. Look at her. My bride-to-be. Has any man ever been so blessed?
No, Your Highness, is all he had to say.
Am I wrong, do you think, to go to any lengths then to protect her?
No, Your Highness. We offered him a main role, but he thought this would be more fun.
These guilders are everywhere. I wish to increase security for the wedding. Write this down.
Yes, Your Highness. And he's done by lunch. Except come the day of recording, he doesn't show. Can you believe he actually sent his manicurist instead?
I want 100 guards at the front gate. All 500th anniversary arrangements are cancelled until after the wedding. The wedding is tomorrow sunset. My bride and I will ride my white stallions to the Florin Channel surrounded by all my guards. Then we will board a ship and begin our honeymoon surrounded by every ship in the Florin Armada.
Every ship but four.
Of course, my pretty little snickerdoodle. How forgetful. Every ship but four.
The four ships were never sent. Don't bother lying to me anymore.
Whatever was done for your own good, Popsicle.
Somehow, I do not think so.
You're nervous. We're getting married tomorrow.
No, I am very calm. It doesn't matter whether you sent the ships or not. Wesley will come for me.
You're a silly girl. Go to your room.
Yes, I am a silly girl. And yes, again, I will go to my room. And you are nothing but a coward.
The greatest hunter in the world, and you say I am a coward?
I do. You only hunt to reassure yourself that you're not what you are. The weakest thing to ever walk the earth.
Be quiet.
Wesley will come for me and you will be helpless.
Be quiet.
Because he and I are joined by the bond of love and you cannot track that. Not with 1,000 bloodhounds, you cannot break it. Not with 1,000 swords.
Quiet! Ah!
The prince threw Buttercup into her room and locked the door. Then he started running towards the zoo of death. I remember when my father read this part, he pretended to lose his place, then skipped 5 pages.
Why would I do something like that?
Because of what happens next.
And you wait till now to complain about it?
No, I just mean I know why you did it. I'm going to wait to tell them until they absolutely have to know.
What that sound?
Fezzik, that is the sound of ultimate suffering. That was the sound of my heart when Count Rugen slaughtered my father. The man in black makes it now.
You think it's him?
I know it. Make a path, Fezzik.
Move! Move out of the way! Thank you.
Sorry.
Excuse us. Sorry.
Oh, sorry. Fezzik, please. Oh, sorry. Whoops. Thank you.
I don't see him.
It came from one of these buildings.
Let's ask that strange, pale woman with the wheelbarrow. I'm having the devil's own trouble tracking that scream.
I heard nothing.
Fezzik, hold her. What is this place?
It is the Princess Zoo, the Zoo of Death.
He's not going to bring the visitors in, call it that.
Is he in there? A sailor brought by Rugen?
Through the door. 5 levels down, but you're too late.
We'll see about that. Quiet for a while, Fezzik.
Chapter 7, The Wedding. The false door was Rugen's idea. The real entrance was behind a tree. A root lifted, and a spiral staircase took you straight down. The main entrance was a false entrance, which took you down the levels the traditional way, first to second to third, or actually second to death.
Level 1, enemies of speed.
Why would the prince have a zoo underground?
Maybe he only likes underground animals, like moles and other moles.
Well, there's another sign. Stairs to level 2.
Stay close. Level 2. Enemies of strength.
I'm not sure the prince wants people to visit his zoo. If I tell you something, will you promise not to laugh?
My word.
I'm just scared to pieces.
Be sure it eases.
It's a wonderful rhyme.
Some other time. Stairs to level 3.
What?
There's a curve. We can't see the bottom from here.
Fear.
Fezzik, if you can't control yourself, you can go upstairs and wait on your own.
Don't. I meant to say beer. I don't know how the F got in there.
Keep it together, honestly. Let's just find the man in black and... The candles. The candles went out.
The door locked itself.
Don't be frightened.
I'm not. What are we going to do?
Simple.
Are you frightened too?
Well, can't a man stutter when he's distracted by feelings of extreme calm? We'll go down. And because you're a bit edgy, I'll let you walk with an arm around my shoulders and eye, so you don't feel foolish. We'll put an arm around you and thus we will descend. Here's where the curve starts.
Why do you think they locked the door behind us?
To add spice.
And they took away the candles for the same reason, spice?
Most likely. Don't squeeze me so hard.
Don't squeeze me quite so hard.
Stop pressing on my neck.
Stop pressing on my neck!
Fezzik!
There has been for many years a running battle among jungle zoologists as to just which of the giant snakes is the mightiest. The anaconda men are forever trumpeting the Orinoco specimen that weighed well over 500 pounds, while the python people never fail to point out that the African rock found outside Zambezi measured 34 feet. But any serious snake enthusiast must admit that the Arabian Gastini is quicker and more ravenous than either. And this specimen of Prince Humperdinck's was not only remarkable for its speed and agility, it was also kept in a permanent state just existing on the outskirts of starvation.
Too strong!
Nothing is too strong for you! Fight!
Forgive me, Inigo!
Fezzik! Fezzik!
What?
I had such rhymes for you!
What rhymes? Inigo? 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 I want to know the rhymes before I die. Inigo, tell me the rhymes. You're not leaving me until I know those rhymes.
Actually, I had no specific rhymes in mind. I just had to do something to get you into action.
You lied to me?
Oh,
my only friend!
Level 3. Poisoners. Women's fashion. Haberdashery. And no, just poisoners.
Fezzik, of course I will have rhymes. one lie in all these years.
Such a thing as principle.
Stop! At least look where we're going.
It's just stairs. Can't be as bad as where we've been. The candles!
I told you! You hear something? What is that?
Bats! King bats!
So terrible about...
Rabies! Rabies!
Down, Fezzik! Lie flat! Who? Quiet! A few bats are no match for the sword of Inigo Montoya. Ha! Ha!
Ha! Ha!
Some giant you are.
Inigo, I made a mistake before. You didn't lie. You tricked me. And tricking is fine. So I'm not mad anymore. Is that all right with you? It's all right with me.
You mean you'll forgive me completely for saving your life if I completely forgive you for saving mine?
You are my friend. My only one.
Level 4 was enemies of fear, and it was the worst yet. These are some of the noises they heard in the darkness. And also this. But when they came at last to the final set of stairs, everything looked alarmingly normal.
It looks empty.
Don't believe it. Hold the door, or the candles will go out. Fezzik, I'm frightened.
It looks all right, though.
But that's to fool us. This must be worse.
But there's nothing to see, Inigo.
That's why I'm so frightened. Death is here. There's no way I'm going to reach the bottom and turn that door handle and just survive.
Can I come join you now?
There's no point in your dying, too.
But it's empty.
If I could see it, I could fight it. I'm Inigo Montoya. Come for me!
Now you're scaring me.
Fezzik, no!
The green speckled recluse doesn't destroy as quickly as the stonefish, and many think the mamba brings more suffering, what with the ulcerating, but gram for gram, nothing in the universe comes close to the green speckled recluse. Prince Humperdinck's spider lived below the ornate green handle on the bottom door. She rarely moved, unless the handle turned. Then she struck like lightning.
We'll go down together. There's nothing here, Inigo.
There has to be.
Why?
Because the prince is a fiend, and Wugan is his twin in misery.
That's wonderful thinking, Inigo, but you can't be scared like this, because that means I have to be the leader, and I'm not a good leader, Inigo. The idea of it just makes me...
Isaac! Broke the door. You just knocked it flat. Oh, spider.
Wow, that was a big one. Where'd that come from?
Who knows? I guess you were right, though. There was nothing dangerous in that stairway after all.
Inigo, look, huh? The man in black. Is he?
No, no, no.
Well, that's a relief. I thought he was dead.
Fezzik, after everything we've been through, how did this happen?
You gotta tell him now.
I know.
The scream, remember? Of ultimate suffering?
I know. The prince locked Buttercup in her room, and then he started running. Running towards the zoo of death.
Your Highness, is everything all right?
She loves you, Wesley. She loves you still, and you love her. So think of that. You might have been genuinely happy. Not one couple in a century has that chance, no matter what the storybooks say. And so, I think, no one will ever suffer a loss as great as you.
No, Your Highness. No one can live past 20.
I, Inigo Montoya, son of Domingo Montoya, do not accept this. Pick him up, Fezzik. Have you got any money?
Some.
Let's hope it's enough to buy a miracle.
Go away. I'm feeding my wits.
Is that Miracle Max?
I'm retired. Anyway, you wouldn't want someone the king fired, would you? I might kill whoever you want me to miracle.
He's already dead.
He is? I'm good at that.
Please.
I'm making no promises. Put him on the table.
So how long does it usually take? We're in a bit of a rush.
Don't hurry me, sonny. You hurry a miracle man, you get rotten miracles. How much money you got?
65 gold.
I never worked for anything that little in my life. And what's so special I should bring this fella back out of all the hundreds pestering me?
He has a widow and 15 sick children.
Oh, sonny, are you a liar? I'll ask him. Pass me those bellows.
But he's dead.
They're sort of dead, mostly dead, and all dead. This fella, he's only sort of dead. So, if I pump a little air...
He's starting to swell up.
Hey, dead guy. What's so important? What do you want to come back for? It takes a minute to work its way out.
True love. True love is worthwhile.
Sonny, true love is the best thing in the world, except for cough drops. Everybody knows that.
Then you'll save him?
I would, but what your friend said was to bluff. He's involved in a shady business deal or a card game, so I'm sorry. Goodbye. Don't forget your corpse on the way out.
Liar! Liar!
Back, witch!
I'm not a witch. I'm your wife. He said true love, Max. Even I could hear it. True love.
Don't go on.
He's rejecting you because he is afraid. Afraid that the miracles are gone from his once majestic fingers.
Valerie, we've been married for 80 years. How can you say this to me?
Because true love is expiring, and you haven't the decency to try? Prince Humperdinck was right to fire you.
Don't say that name in this hut, Valerie. You made a pledge.
Prince Humperdinck, Prince Humperdinck. At least he knows a phony when he sees one.
But this is his fiancée's true love.
Is it?
The prince tortured him to death. It's the only way that makes sense.
Well, not the only way.
Shh. If you bring him back to life, he will stop Prince Humperdinck's marriage.
Prince Humperdinck suffers?
Humiliations galore.
Get me my resurrection recipe book.
So, how long does he have to maintain full efficiency?
Well, that's hard to predict. We have to storm the castle.
Let's say an hour. Either it's plenty or you'll both be dead.
And then we have to stop a wedding. I need to duel my nemesis. Then we make her escape.
Max, they need a fighting corpse.
Okay, what happens next in Morgenstern's novel is an alteration of scenes switching between the kooky royal wedding traditions of the castle, such as where Buttercup is asked to walk barefoot on the grave of her fiancé's grandfather. Meanwhile, Max has to send Inigo and Fezzik on a couple of mini-quests to pick up ingredients for the resurrection pill, because they don't make those out of just anything, you know.
Where do I get frog dust?
Where else? Gotta dust you some frogs.
And so on. It's all exciting stuff, but we're building to a climax now, so I'm just going to show you the edited highlights.
You gotta sneak up on them, because if they wake up, boing! Frogs ain't dusty no more.
We'll be careful. Come on, Fezzik.
No. I got a job for him, too. I need Holocaust mud.
Mud doesn't sound so bad.
Holocaust mud? It's on fire. Good news is, it's easy to get as long as you have a Holocaust cloak. Guess what the bad news is.
Back and forth, and each time, Morgenstern lets you know it's 16 hours. It's 15 hours until the ceremony.
Oh, yes?
Your son-in-law sent me for the Holocaust cloak. He gave me one of his teeth so you'd know it was really him.
My husband wears it in bed. He has very abrasive leg hair. One sudden move, and woof!
Anyway, we pick things up 13 hours later, 2 hours before the wedding. Inigo and Fezzik take Wesley and the pill and head off to storm the castle.
That was a beautiful pill, honey. What's wrong? You look worried.
Didn't they want an hour? When I doubled the recipe, I'm not sure I doubled it enough. I don't think it'll work over 40 minutes.
Even a genius gets rusty. 40 minutes will be plenty.
Open his jaw. We'll have to push it in.
How long do we have to wait before we...
Couldn't beat me alone, you villains. I'll beat you both together. Why won't my arms move?
You've been dead. We bought a resurrection pill, and it works for 60 minutes.
Except it wasn't 60, it was 40.
I can't move my legs. Are we enemies? I'm the Dread Pirate Roberts, but you could call me Wesley.
Fezzik.
Inigo Montoya. Let me tell you what's been going on. No, it's too much. The wedding is at 6. We have 1 hour to get in, steal the princess, and get out. But not before I kill Count Rugen.
What are our liabilities?
There is one working castle gate, and it's guarded by 100 men.
And our assets?
Your brains, physic strength, my steel.
That's all? It's impossible.
You just moved your head. Doesn't that lift your spirits?
You think a little head jiggle is supposed to make me happy? Why didn't you leave me to death, lying here helpless while my true love marries my murderer?
Once you're over your emotional outbursts, we'll come up with a...
I mean, if we had a wheelbarrow even, that would be something.
That zookeeper had a wheelbarrow.
Maybe we can get a wheelbarrow.
Well, why don't you list that amongst our assets?
You just sat up.
100 men. What I'd give for a Holocaust cloak.
There we can't help you.
Yeah. Will this do?
Fezzik.
What? I think it makes me look distinguished.
All right. There may be other problems once we're inside. Take me to your wheelbarrow.
Buttercup, for her part, had never felt such a wonderful feeling of calm. Her Wesley was coming. So when she heard the wedding was to be moved up, she wasn't the least upset.
If Wesley can rescue me at 6, he can just as happily rescue me at 5:30.
Actually, Prince Humperdinck got things going even faster than he hoped. It was 5:23 when he and his bride-to-be were kneeling before the Archdean of Florin. It was 5:24 when the Archdean started to speak. And 5:25 when the screaming started outside.
Here comes my Wesley.
I am the Dread Pirate Roberts, and there will be no survivors. I am the Dread Pirate Roberts.
Stay calm.
There will be no survivors.
Not 100 of us. He's just a giant in a wheelbarrow. He's on fire. He's on fire.
I am the Dread Pirate Roberts, and there will be no survivors.
Chapter 8. The Honeymoon.
Marriage is a sacred union. What is all that screaming?
Oh, holiness, my love is simply overpowering my ability to wait. Please skip to the end.
Wesley runs so beautifully, don't you think?
Marriage is a sacred union.
Man and wife, say that.
I'm not there yet.
You just arrived.
4 guards outside, 10 seconds per guard. He's very good with guards. I hope he still thinks I'm pretty.
Come on, man and wife.
Man and wife, you're man and wife.
Thank you, Holiness. Count Rugen.
Congratulations,
yes, Highness. Yes. Stop that commotion.
It will be my pleasure.
But Wesley is usually so punctual.
Oh, sorry. Did I not mention? Wesley's dead.
No. You're lying.
I assure you, I killed him myself. Escort Princess Buttercup to my bedchamber. I will find her there presently.
It's after 5:30. Can you go any faster?
I tell you what, next time you get tortured to death and resurrected, and I'll be the one who complains about it.
I'm sorry, I still have to find Rugen. He could be anywhere.
Guards, this way. I can hear them squabbling.
Or he could be running towards us.
Wesley, how are you alive?
I have a great skincare regime.
Kill them, but leave the man in black. He and I have some...
Oh, I'm sorry. Could I have waited for you to stop talking before I killed all your guards?
Who are you?
Inigo had dreamt of this moment. In the beginning, he'd had all sorts of wild vengeance notions, forcing his enemy to beg, trapping him into admitting his crime. In the end, he realized there was beauty in simplicity.
My name is Inigo Montoya. You killed my father. Prepare to die.
Wesley. I can't live in a world where you've died more than once. So, the only thing left is to choose which of my husband's many hunting knives I used to come and join you.
Come back, Rugen, you coward!
Fezzik, break this door down. Fezzik?
I'm protecting Wesley.
He's getting away, Fezzik. Quickly! Thank you.
What do I do now?
Back to Wesley.
Wesley! Which way did he go?
The choice is made. My darling Wesley. I come.
I would have gone with the one with the nice handle.
And there was Wesley on the bed. It was 5:45, and she knew that she would never die.
I promised you I'd always come.
Wesley, for his part, assumed he had till 6:15 for his hour to be up. Except he never had an hour. He had 40 minutes. Meanwhile, Inigo was gaining. After 25 years, soon he would be alone in a room with his revenge.
Hello. My name is Inigo Mont...
I was hoping to kill Wesley again, but I suppose you'll have to do...
Father, I'm sorry.
Wesley, why did you just lie there smiling?
I'm pleased to see you.
There are other ways to send that message.
Gently.
Are you angry at me for getting married?
You're not married. Not in my church or any other.
But the Archdean?
Widows happen every day, don't they, Your Highness?
To the death. Again.
No, to the pain.
I don't think I quite understand that.
I'll be only too delighted to explain.
It was 5:48 now. Only 7 minutes left. But Wesley did not know that. How could he? Slowly, carefully, he began to talk.
Forgive me, Father.
You're that little Spanish brat I taught a lesson to. Have you been chasing me all these years, only to fail now? How marvelous!
No.
Oh, stay down. Let me put you out of your misery.
Hello. My name is Inigo Montoya. You killed my father. I'm prepared to die. Hello. My name is Inigo Montoya. You killed my father. Prepare to die. Hello. My name is Inigo Montoya. You killed my father! Prepare to die!
You're insane!
Hello! My name is Inigo Montoya! You killed my father! Prepare to die!
My face! Also my face!
Hello! My name is Inigo Montoya!
Stop saying that!
Hello! My name is Inigo Montoya. You killed my father. Prepare to die.
No!
Offer me money.
Everything.
Power, too. Promise me that.
All I have and more, please.
Offer me anything I ask for.
Yes, yes, take it.
I want Domingo Montoya!
Inigo looked down at the dead count. His eyes bulged wide, full of horror and pain. It was glorious. If you like that kind of thing.
I loved it.
It was 5:52 now. 3 minutes left. Wesley thought he had 23.
Drop your sword, and I will leave with the princess, and you will be tied up, but not fatally. If you choose to fight, well, we will not both leave alive.
You have been prisoner for months, and I myself killed you less than a day ago. I think you are bluffing.
Possibly true. And when the moment comes, remember that I might indeed be bluffing. I could, in fact, be lying on this bed because I lack the strength to stand. All that, weigh carefully.
You are only alive now because you said to the pain. I want that phrase explained.
My pleasure. Surely you must have guessed I am no ordinary sailor. I am, in fact, Roberts himself.
I am, in fact, not the least surprised or awed.
To the pain means this. If we duel and you win, death for me. If we duel and I win, life for you. But life on my terms.
Meaning?
The first thing you will lose will be your feet. The left, then the right. Then your hands at the wrist.
Less than 2 minutes left. Wesley became aware that something was happening to his body.
Next, your nose. No smell of dawn for you. Followed by your tongue, and then your left eye.
And then my right eye, and then my ears. Shall we get on with it?
It was 5:54. 1 minute left.
Wrong. Your ears you keep, so that every shriek of every child at seeing your hideousness will be yours to cherish. Every woman that cries, "Dear God, what is that thing?" will reverberate forever with your perfect ears. That is what pain means. It means that I leave you to live in anguish, in humiliation, until you can stand it no more. So there you have it, you miserable, vomitous mass. Live or die, it's up to you. Drop your sword!
It was 5:55.
Oh, I knew you were bluffing!
Now you will suffer to the pain!
Sorry, look, nothing in my hands.
Tie him. Use the curtain sashes.
Where's Fezzik?
Isn't he with you?
What are you doing here?
Help Wesley up.
Wesley? Why does he need help?
Because he has no strength at all. Now please, do as I say.
You were bluffing, I knew it!
Oops.
Did you at least win your battle?
I did.
Let us find some place to defend ourselves. At least perhaps we can go together.
I'll help you up her, darling.
Inigo! I need you! Inigo, I'm lost!
Fezzik! Up here!
Oh, Inigo! I'm sorry. I got so lost when I found these pretty horses and I thought four was how many we would be if we found the lady. Hello, lady!
Fezzik! You thought for yourself. If only we had a ladder.
Oh, don't worry. I'll catch you.
So, while Humperdinck struggled, they jumped, one at a time, and Fezzik caught them gently and put them on the white stallions, and they would have got away without any trouble at all, except...
Stop them! Cut them off!
They were, admittedly, startled, but there was no reason for worry. They were on the fastest horses in the kingdom, and the lead was already theirs.
And they all lived happily ever after. Good night now. Don't sleep too little.
That's how my father ended it. However, this was before Inigo's wound reopened, and Wesley relapsed again. And Fezzik took the wrong turn, and Buttercup's horse threw a shoe. And the night behind them was filled with the crescendoing sound of pursuit. Morgenstern was a satirist, so... he left it that way, and my father was, I realized too late, a romantic. So he ended it another way.
What do you mean another way? That's how it ends. Good night already.
Good night, Dad. But I'm the abridger, and I'm entitled to a few ideas of my own. Did they make it?
I think so.
Was the pirate ship waiting for them?
Absolutely.
And Wesley got his strength back, and we went on to have all kinds of adventures.
But that doesn't mean they had a happy ending either, because in my opinion, they squabbled a lot.
No, we didn't.
Yes, we did.
And Buttercup lost her looks eventually.
Ow!
And one day, Fezzik lost a fight. And some hotshot kid whipped Inigo with a sword. But he was fine. And Wesley was never able to really sleep sound because of Humperdinck maybe being on their trail.
Doesn't he have anything better to do?
I'm a prince. Of course I don't.
I'm not trying to make this a downer, understand?
True love, hate, revenge, giants.
I mean, I really do think that love is the best thing in the world. Except for cough drops.
Bad men, good men, beautifulest ladies.
And we will always keep coming back to these stories. The inarticulate fathers, the demanding children, the hack radio writers, and all of you. To the good parts, anyway. But I also have to say, for the umpteenth time, that life is unfair. It's just fairer than death, that's all.
In The Princess Bride, Buttercup was played by Ruby Barker, Fezzik by Tyler Collins, Inigo, Eamon Elliott, Count Rugen, Robin Lane, Goldman Sr. and Max, Crawford Logan, Wesley, Lorne MacDonald, Prince Humperdinck and William Goldman, Grant O'Rourke, and Valerie and the Zookeeper by Rosalind Sidney. The Princess Bride was written by William Goldman and dramatised by Stephen Keyworth. Sound design was by Fraser Jackson. It was a BBC Scotland production directed by Kirsty Williams.